welcome to Talking Geopolitics. I'm Christian Smith, and on this episode, we turn to the EU, where vaccination rates are increasing, COVID restrictions are easing, and the economy is beginning to bounce back. Perhaps inevitably then, debate now has begun about when to end the European Central Bank's emergency bond scheme, which has pumped more than €1 trillion into the EU during the pandemic. But chairman and founder George Friedman believes that the debate is more than about COVID and shows yet again fundamental divisions in the EU's fiscal structure. Also later on, as NATO pulls out of Afghanistan, head of analysis Alison Vidurka tells us why the move's potential impact on the rest of Central Asia is front and centre on her radar. But first, last year saw clashes between Indian and Chinese soldiers on the Himalayan border. Increasing tensions between the world's most populous countries has been an obvious trend of global geopolitics in recent years. Last week, India sent a further 50,000 troops to the border, an increase of 40% on last year. And I spoke to East Asia expert Philip Orchard to understand the situation in the Himalayas and its meaning for the wider Indo-Chinese relationship. Phil, we saw a clash last year in the Himalayas between Chinese and Indian troops that resulted in the death of about 20 Indian troops and an unknown number of Chinese soldiers. What's been happening there in the last year since that happened?
Well, not a lot, because it's hard to do much of anything in for about 8 months of the year in the high Himalayas, which is one of the things that really prevents the issue from escalating into an all-out war. Of course, it has in the past, but just the topography and the weather and everything, it's so hard to move troops through there. It's so everything becomes just extraordinarily difficult. The last time they actually fought a war, roughly a third of Indian troops ended up with really, really bad altitude sickness. Helicopters don't fly as easily. It's really hard to do a whole lot. So basically, that kind of contains it from escalating on a major level. But what both countries are doing, which is sort of contributing to this continuing low-level instability, and where now every summer when the snow melts and you can actually do stuff up there, it becomes a really high risk of low-level clashes, is on both sides of the line of actual control, been building out all sorts of new infrastructure, from just basic stuff like roads and bridges to airfields and hospital pads, and actually developing some infrastructure to allow for a more year-round presence.
Phil, it's a bit of a kind of corner of the world, so to speak. Obviously, it's a border between the two countries, but what's the interest for China and India in this Himalayan border?
Yeah, it's a little bit curious because it's so hard to do anything. It's a little bit, if they really just wanted it to be stable, which, most countries have an interest in stability above all, they could just stop building infrastructure and neither country would feel threatened, and they could just kind of let it be this nice natural buffer zone between them. But there's a lot of theories for why China especially keeps pressing and keeps pushing it, forcing the issue and, seizing the high ground and stuff, and kind of going above and beyond to make very minor tactical gains. One of our theories is that China really wants India to be as focused as possible on land-based threats, whether in the Himalayas or in Kashmir, where Pakistan, can cause all sorts of problems. Pakistan, which is very close to China, and much of its military strength is owed to China. India has incredible potential as a naval power, but they've had a really hard time. Becoming an actual blue water naval power is incredibly expensive. You have to really prioritize it from a resources and manpower perspective. And the Indian military is still overwhelmingly focused on land-based threats. And it's especially expensive and especially a big resource suck to fight in the Himalayas. And so the more that China can keep India preoccupied in the Himalayas, whether for strategic or for political reasons, or, you know, just the uproar after last summer has sort of forced India to continue to, or even increase its focus on the Himalayas. The more that China can do that, the less India will be focused on, for example, developing the resources to block, you know, contribute to a blockade around the mouth of the Strait of Malacca, where India's Andaman and Nicobar Islands are just extraordinarily valuable location there, putting India in prime position if it wanted to really cause a lot of problems for Chinese shipping traffic.
I mean, more broadly as well, this is sort of fundamentally about the future of Asia, isn't it? And even by extent, the world. I mean, this is, it's hard to avoid the fact that this is a dispute or a period of tension between the world's two largest countries, population-wise, and ones that are obviously China is very much so is, but India is increasingly becoming important geopolitically to the rest of the world as well.
Yeah, and it's curious that China is making an enemy out of India, because they really could just, or theoretically, they could just pretty easily live in separate spheres. But because China has no choice but to push into the Indian Ocean basin to secure its core interests, it's sort of become inevitable that it's going to start increasingly bumping up against India's traditional sphere of influence and core interests. And so we're starting to see all sorts of pretty direct competition there, whether in proxy countries like in Sri Lanka or Pakistan or the Maldives or other places where both countries have been trying to develop naval infrastructure and so forth. So it's one of those things where China kind of doesn't really have a choice but to push into there, and therefore they kind of don't have a choice but to make it something of an enemy out of India. And this is kind of the result that we're seeing.
So is China's desire to sort of tie up India in the Himalayas and to make an enemy out of India, really, is that backfiring because it's making India more involved in the rest of the world?
Yeah, basically. In the Himalayas itself, is the China's actions in the Himalayas itself are contributing to the backlash of, you know, India historically has tried to be a pretty non-aligned power. It doesn't see itself as a natural member of a US-led bloc, or, you know, it sees itself as its own thing, and most of its problems are internal or on its border with with Pakistan. But because of the nature of the events last summer, it really has sparked a political backlash toward China that is making it much more difficult for the two countries, or for India, to stay non-aligned and so forth. But again, maybe that's China could be considering that successful. India has increased its troop commitment to the Himalayas by something like 40% over the past year. Again, you could say that's exactly what China wants.
So, Phil, just to finish, where do we see this going in the short and medium term? I mean, do we expect more clashes on the border, and do we expect any potential this might escalate, or is this one just a bit of a slow burn, one to watch?
Yeah, I think it'll be a slow burn. I mean, there's a high potential for additional clashes. So kind of what we're getting at earlier, the nature of the geography of the Himalayas creates strategic stability because it's really hard for a major war to break out between the two countries there. But it does create perpetual sort of low-level tactical instability, because the nature of fighting in the Himalayas puts an extraordinary premium on very minor tactical gains. So if you can control this high ground, then you can control this valley. If you can control this choke point, then, you know, and so forth. And so that's why you see them, you know, coming to blows and shoving each other into ice cold rivers and so forth, over these empty plots of land that it's not immediately obviously what's at stake. But when you look at the map and you kind of see, like, well, if either country wants to be able to run supply lines through this area, then they need to control this choke point or this valley or whatever. Yeah. So low level instability is kind of baked in, even if it doesn't rise to the level of strategic instability.
Philip Orchard, thanks very much.
My pleasure.
Now, moving northwest of the Himalayas, head of analysis Alison Fedurka is closely watching Central Asia as the US-led NATO mission pulls out of Afghanistan. Alison, what's on your radar there?
What we're looking at is the reaction of Afghan fighters and the Taliban to the power void that is being left and created by the withdrawal of primarily U.S. troops, but also all of the other supporting NATO member troops from Afghanistan. And most recently, what we've seen in the last week or two are two major developments. The first is the advancement of the Taliban in terms of gaining territorial control of many districts in Afghanistan, particularly in the north, and also then the displacement of Afghan fighters, with Tajikistan reporting on multiple occasions and in multiple locations, Afghan troops or fighters crossing over into the border of Tajikistan because of their fighting with the Taliban in the north. In these cases, we've seen the Tajik government help return the fighters back over to their side of the border. But it is clear that the recourse that these Afghan fighters had was to move north into Tajikistan as their more strategic place of retreat rather than stand their ground inside the Afghan borders.
I think the concern here is, isn't it, is that we're looking at potentially the increasing destabilization of the Central Asian region. And then, I mean, is there a chance that we could get a sort of reiteration of the great game we had in the 19th century?
Yes. The short answer is yes, most definitely. The writing is on the wall for that already. So back in the 19th century with the Great Game, we saw the British Empire and the Russian Empire fighting over influence in Afghanistan, with the general idea being that they each wanted to have control and influence over trade routes and other resources in Central and South Asia. So the geography remains the same even in the 21st century. And that means that instability in Afghanistan has a strong probability to spill over into other parts of Central Asia. And that's what gives the situation in Afghanistan its geopolitical relevance. Because if we start to see destabilization in Central Asia, then Russia automatically needs to respond. Central Asia is part of Russia's buffer zone, and it has traditionally been the main actor in terms of how to keep Central Asia stabilized. We've seen these Central Asian governments already reaching out to Moscow for some security support to deal with this situation. But we're also now seeing that as a result of this, Turkey and the United States stepping in as well. So the U.S. doesn't want to see Central Asia fall to pure Russian control. They don't want to keep their troops in Afghanistan. It's not a critical region for them. But anything that they can do to either have Russia get sucked in and bleed resources into stabilization efforts in Central Asia is in the U.S. interest, or that the U.S. can do to support Turkey's endeavors in terms of expanding Turkish influence in Central Asia would also be an acceptable result for the United States in terms of if it has to choose between Turkey or Russian influence in the region. So we are starting to see Turkey pivot more towards Central Asia, with a lot of work being done to enhance the ties between Turkic people, to enhance trade ties between the countries, political ties, as well as some security and military ties with countries in Central and South Asia. So we are definitely seeing a 21st century version of the Great Game taking shape. And a lot of this has to do with the fact that it is all rooted in geography, and that geography is still there.
Alison, certainly one for us to keep an eye on. Thanks very much.
Talking Geopolitics is brought to you by Geopolitical Futures, your source for geopolitical forecasting and analysis.
As the European economy slowly recovers from the pandemic, the inevitable question of whether the EU should seek to tighten the purse strings is now on the agenda. Last week, European Central Bank policymakers began openly debating when to end the bank's pandemic emergency purchase program, designed to provide monetary support to the union during the pandemic. Perhaps unsurprisingly, the fiscally conservative Germans and Austrians are eager for an early wind down. But the EU needs to avoid an uneven recovery, and it's the rich Germans who seem to have rebounded better than the likes of Italy or Spain. to understand where the EU's economic recovery may go and how it speaks to the EU's future as a whole, I sat down with George Friedman for this episode's Fireside Chat. George, let's start with this call for the Pandemic Emergency Purchase Programme to be wound down. That's the EU's Emergency Pandemic Bond Purchase Scheme. Look, this is just classic EU economic politics, isn't it?
Well, it's the reality of the EU, which it's not a nation. It's not Germany or Italy or one to which the central bank can create a solution to its problems. It's many nations grouped together under an organization, and the central bank can't create a solution for all of Europe's problems. It winds up creating solutions for the strongest ones or the more manipulative ones, the more effective ones. But the needs of a country like Italy is so wildly different from the needs of Germany at this point that if it's a German policy being followed, Italy is hurt by it. If it's a Italian policy being hurt, then it's a German policy. This goes to the heart of the entire European project. The European project assumed that there's a universal European interest. There isn't. There's a bunch of individual states who need very different things. And as a pseudo-government, they just can't serve them all.
I suppose my question to that would be, you know, compare that to the United States. Then I'm explain how that's different to how the United States work.
Well, the United States created a country in a century before it began creating complex central banks and so on. There is a general interest in the United States. It differs from state to state. And the states have had histories of fighting each other during the Civil War, and these will matter. But when we get down to it, American industry, American business is American. It is broadly distributed. When inflation begins in one region, it usually is in the other region. When you have a lack of money, the same thing happens. So you could find policies that will, of course, be criticized and attacked, but don't go materially against the interests of the country. Europe's whole adventure is a warring continent that slaughtered each other over the course of the first part of the century, trying to come together as if they were one, in spite of the fact that their history has left them not only in very different conditions that requires a different economic policy, but also winds up in a situation that they don't like each other very much. And so it's a question of time. It's also a question of variability of countries. The difference between a Germany and a Greece is striking. You get differences like that in the United States as well, but they're not as striking, and at least we speak one language.
Well, yeah, let's go back to Europe then. I mean, this idea of the North-South divide in Europe has been in place for a long time, but since before the EU, really. But at the same time, it obviously seems to worsen around financial crises. We saw that back in 2008, and now again with COVID. But in some ways, it's worse than that, isn't it? Because it's not necessarily just a North-South divide, but it's also it's actually more of a Germany against everyone else divide.
It is that. It is also a West-East divide. But look, when you have a rising sea, all the boats float higher. You don't get the problems there. But Europe has had three extreme problems. First was the 2008 crisis, which required very painful selection of who was going to benefit. Of course, the Greek crisis was attached to it. The second was the immigration crisis. That wasn't an economic crisis per se, was that too. But it really came down to the question of who made decisions and how did it affect various people. The question of where the immigrants went and who paid for them. I mean, these became torturous questions. It became a social issue. Now you have the COVID crisis, which is emerging with an inevitable economic problem that can be solved, but it can't be solved universally with all the different varieties of problems that there are. So in the United States, we have the problem as well, and many of the functions, powers, are taken from the federal government and left to the states. In the state of Texas, they're taken from the state and mostly handled by counties. We break it down. Not as much as we used to, but we break it down. Europe is looking for a single solution to 2008, a single solution to the immigration crisis, a single solution to COVID crisis among profoundly discrete nations. That's very hard to do.
Let's break it down a bit then. Let's start with the South, start with countries like Italy and Spain and Greece. I mean, what do they need at the moment? I mean, I can speak from someone who's sitting in London saying, you know, this summer, even more so than last year, it seems like it could well be one with very little tourism, particularly from the UK, due to COVID still and due to the Delta variant. Those are obviously extremely important. Tourism is probably the most important aspect of most of those economies. What do those southern economies need?
Well, they need not to be a tourist economy, first off, because tourist economies are very fragile to all sorts of things, and also doesn't allow them to grow their net worth, the net worth of their industries. Max Weber, in the 19th century, wrote a book called The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, in which he looked at the Catholic states, he was, of course, German, and the Northern European states and said, look, these are completely different cultures. They have different values. They approach problems completely differently. Weber, who is a very famous sociologist, really hit it on the head. Italy and Germany have very different interests. Italy, for example, has a division between North and South. The Northern part, is most interested in remaining close to the EU. It does very nicely out of it. The southern part that has never flourished really economically is being hammered. So you have created a political crisis inside of Italy between North and South. And then it's hard for the Italians to create a coherent policy. And even if they create a coherent policy, it's very hard to get Europe, in this case, the European Central Bank, to support it. The ECB makes Europe's the policy for the euro. The Italians are in the euro. What they need more than anything else as a country as a whole is a lot more money, creating liquidity in the system. The Germans are terrified of liquidity in the system. In their history, liquidity has meant inflation that was catastrophic in the 1920s and 30s. So you have two really fundamental differences. And we're only speaking of two nations here. When you go off to Poland or you go to Spain, it's even deeper. And the British, of course, have left because the differentiation was too great. It was a rational move that the British, who opposed it, tried to make it appear to be some sort of strange move. But the point was, Britain controlling its own money supply makes a lot more sense than trying to create a coordinated money supply with a single value among all the members of the EU.
As these countries start to recover from COVID and the financial economic implications of that, do you think we're going to see a further entrenching of these divisions? And by that, I guess I mean, you know, an uneven recovery where countries like Germany do significantly better, like in 2008, than the southern countries?
Well, every time there's a crisis in Europe, you have separation. 2008, immigration, no COVID. Of course, each economy is very different. As you put it before, I mean, Italy needs tourists. Germany needs customers for its cars and technology. The needs are very, very different. And the problem here is that every time a crisis occurs, and they occur with some regularity, there's a divergence of interests among the countries. And it's very hard to bridge it. But also, you know, remember, economics is linked in closely to foreign policy. I mean, the idea that there is economic policy distinct from foreign policy is illusionary. Right now, Europe has a foreign policy issue, its relationship with the United States, and its relationship with China. You see Hungary pulling closer to China at a time when the rest of Europe is at most neutral and possibly hostile to China. And that in turn creates questions of economics, because the China question is partly an economic question. And there is no official EU foreign policy. There is EU official economic policy, but it can't be subtle. It can't take into account all the differences.
So, George, I think the question that inevitably comes is, you know, we've seen crises in the EU before, in 2008 again in particular. And I think a lot of people would say that what happened after 2008 wasn't a fix of the problem, but just a papering over of the cracks. Do you see this particular scenario right now leading even further down the line, or should I say, creating more of a likelihood of some kind of split in the EU, some kind of structural formal split? Or do you think they'll just keep muddling through like they did after 2008?
Well, there already is an informal structural split. Nobody admits it, but different countries are going different ways. Here's the problem. Europe had an excellent idea in a free trade zone, DC. That problem did not address the question of internal politics of various countries, of internal policies, didn't require a single currency, but did create a free zone, free trade zone that worked. The European Union went too far. It imagined a single Europe without understanding itself that Europe is not a single place. So it took a very good idea of the European community and turned it into a quasi-nation. Well, it's not that. So institutionally, Europe either reforms itself, and that will mean, I think, more than anything else, returns to national currencies for those countries who want a national currency, and facilitates it so they can control their own money supply and everything else, or countries will, like Britain, leave on their own. I mean, everybody looks at Brexit and says, well, you know, the British are foolish. This is the second largest economy in Europe that left. It was a stunning blow to, which ought to have been a stunning blow to the EU to really rethink what it's doing. Instead, it carried out its negotiations with Britain, not in a collaborative fashion, but in an antagonistic fashion. Neither side was very interested in coordinating, but it was Europe that needed Britain not to leave, because Britain has now created the precedent. And the Europeans have tried to create a precedent. This will be as hard as we can make it. Well, that doesn't really hold things together. So a couple of things, you know, really have to happen. The European Union, if it wants to survive, has to have an elected government. And that government must be elected by the people and representative of somehow of Europe as it is. Bureaucrats are a necessary entity in the world, but they cannot govern. They can implement. When bureaucrats govern, they are insensitive to what's happening frequently around them. Can Europe admit that? Can Europe accept it? I think not. I think the British model that you've seen is actually the forerunner of what's going to happen in the EU. I don't see how Italy possibly solves its problems with a monetary policy set in Berlin. It can't, and it has to leave. Now, Britain was fairly strong. Italy is weaker. But the problem is that Italy is weakening under this regime. Other countries like Poland and Hungary are quite tired of being told that they are not liberal democratic. When their governments are elected, people criticize them, but they are not holding to European values, okay? So there's not only economic tension, just political tension. Europe is claiming that the rule of law must be respected, when the Hungarians and Poles say, we have our laws, we are respecting them. And what Europe is really saying, we don't like the kind of government you have. Well, that is getting to dangerous points. So my view is that Europe, the European Union, is headed toward a more authoritarian standard for other nations, at the same time that the standards they're holding themselves are forcing other nations out of it. And watching Italy, and I say Germany, but I really mean Europe, the rest of Europe, try to find a common interest, it's very hard to do. And in fact, you hear in Germany many times about the irresponsible Italians. No, they are a different country, and they behave differently and need different things. So I'm very pessimistic about the survival of the EU. Not that the EU couldn't save itself, but institutionally, it doesn't have the flexibility to do so.
George, I think we could spend a lot longer on this, but we're going to have to leave it there. Definitely something to watch as the world starts to hopefully recover from COVID. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
That's all for this episode of Talking Geopolitics from Geopolitical Futures. If you want to access any of George's free weekly articles or learn more about Geopolitical Futures, click the link in the bio. We'll be back again in 2 weeks. Thanks very much for listening. Goodbye.
You've been listening to Talking Geopolitics from the team at Geopolitical Futures. If you like what you've heard, be sure to subscribe to Talking Geopolitics wherever you get your podcasts. We'd love to hear your comments and questions. Go to geopoliticalfutures.com/podcast to leave your feedback. That's geopoliticalfutures.com/podcast.